So here's what we're doing. This series is called the DIY Apocalypse, which means that what we want you to do is we want you to build your own understanding of the end times. We don't want you to found it based on someone's, you know, fabulous New York Times bestseller book or anything, and those aren't bad, but there's so many of them, and they seem to be in conflict in certain interpretations, and that's natural, because as we go on and talk about the end times, it's not that specific, but there are some very specific takeaways you can take. But because it's not that super specific, like it doesn't say, you know, on Monday, you know, it's June 5th, the Bible's not that specific. So there's a lot of interpretation going on. I want you to do what we should always be doing in anything in life, is build your understanding of reality based on what you read with your eyes in the Bible. And you don't have to rely on anyone else to do this, even on end time stuff, you don't have to rely on anyone else. There's even, I just saw two new books out this week by two well-known Christian preachers on the end time stuff, which makes sense because it's triggered by this abysmal election we're in right now. And so it's triggered a lot of end times books. It's just kind of the way it is. So anyway, we're looking at what seems to be the easiest entry spot in the Bible, which would be, what did Jesus say about the end times? Now, there's other places, but this seems like a good starting point. So we are well into it, and here's how it started. In the beginning of Matthew 24, they were at the temple in Israel, in Jerusalem, right there before Jesus is arrested, actually. They're at the temple, they leave the temple, and his apostles and some others say to him, "Wow, what about that temple? Big stones, isn't that incredible?" And Jesus' remarkable response is, well, guess what? You think that's remarkable? "There will not be left one stone upon another that will not be thrown down." Well, that's very apocalyptic, because it's a big building. This is a really big deal. And in the history of Israel, only huge apocalyptic events would destroy the temple. So Jesus says it is impressive, but even as impressive as it is, it's going to be thrown down. Now, that triggered a great curiosity in the apostles. So their curiosity response is, well, tell us, when will these things be, and what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? And his response is the two chapters of Matthew 24 and 25. He's just responding to those. Now, be careful, and we're going to look carefully today at how you interpret the Bible, because you don't want to go past what it says. You just want to stay with what it says, and you want to be careful how you look at it. So don't reinterpret much into that. For instance, look at their question. Is that one question or multiple questions? Multiple. It's actually three questions. It's three questions. And we know actually that the pushing over of the temple happened in 70 AD. Does that mean it has nothing to do with Jesus' second coming? Well, not necessarily. We looked at this a couple weeks ago. It could very well be that what Jesus talked about quite specifically about the pushing over the temple by Titus and the Roman armies in 70 AD not only happened in 70 AD, but will be a type and a figure for how it will happen again later at the end of the age. So there may be actually multiple realizations of that actual prophecy. And that's the beginning of the return of Jesus. Did you know that in the Bible, the last days started when Jesus came the first time and continues on through today? So here's this, we talked about this a lot, this sort of smearing effect. So when Jesus answers their three questions, for us it seems odd. He'll answer a 70 AD question, like when will these stones be pushed? But then when will you come back, and what's the end of the age? And those may be separate events. But Jesus, in his wonderful accommodation, answers all three questions. So the big thing you have to keep in mind is all of these three things, although for humankind will be on different times in the timeline, they are all related in terms of how the final one is going to be. So, for instance, in the same way we talked about the abomination of desolation. Yeah, it's a big word. Well, it turns out that phrase was actually used back in 168 B.C. when the Maccabees and the Greeks came in and did horrible things, had a pig in the temple. That was called the abomination of desolation. Is that a fulfillment of what Jesus talked about in Matthew 24? Well, no, because it was like 168 years before. But what happened then is a good idea for what will happen then. So that's how these things are tied together. The 70 AD, the destruction of the temple, was that the final fulfillment of what Jesus is talking about? No, although it is partially, and that's there, but it also has some kind of connection to what the final event. So these are all things that help us understand. So just keep that in mind. They're all kind of connected together. So we are on this right here. And so today we're going to answer that question in verses 32 to 44. And specifically, we're going to highlight their question about when. Last time we talked about what will happen with an emphasis on what. And last time we talked about the Annie song, the sun will come out tomorrow. Bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. Not. Jesus says there's a day coming where there will be no sun the next day. So as astonishing as that is to believe, things will actually come to an end. And everyone today would say, regardless of what's wrong today, tomorrow's another day. And Jesus says, sorry, there's a day coming where there will be no other day. He's very specific about that. So we looked at that last week about what will happen and his gathering of the elect. But today we're going to talk about when it's going to happen. And remember the emphasis on what the apostles asked. Tell us when these things will be. Well, today we won't talk about so much what will happen. We've just done some of that. We're going to talk about when. When can I look at my watch? When can I set my calendar? When is it going to happen? Here we go. Woo! And this is usually the topic of most of the bestsellers. I can predict. I have a newspaper ad on the back of my office door. It's a full-page ad out of the Ogden Standard. It's a huge paid ad, and it's a full-page ad about the end of the world. And I think it was back in, 2010 or 11, I think it was? Well, no, this was before that even before the 2012 Mayan thing. Yeah, so it's there on my door. It says, it's going to happen. Everyone get your act together. This is the end. And there was a date. There was an actual day of that year. So I should have brought that out because I leave it on my door to remind me, Jim, if you're ever tempted to predict the date, maybe you shouldn't do that because this is embarrassing. But they fully believed it, and they put hundreds of thousands of dollars into ads nationwide, full-page ads in newspapers telling people this is the end. After it wasn't the end, their official answer was, we've probably counted something wrong. I guess so. Today we'll find out why maybe you don't want to do that. So let's take a look at what he says about the when, and we're going to start right here, verse 32. Jesus says, from the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender, puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. Now, these guys are all agricultural types. They know when you see a tree doing this after the wintertime, then you know spring is near. And then once spring and it flower, it blossoms out with leaves, and shortly after that, there's flowers. And where there's flowers, there's fruit, and then the fruit matures, and boom, there it is, right? So we know this stuff. We can see this coming from a distance. So the long winter, you wonder, is winter over? Look at the tree as it starts to blossom. At least the tree knows you're close. So that's all Jesus is saying. You should be able to do this. You do this. So it is with the end times. So also, when you see all these things, you know that he is near at the very gates. Oh, so what are all these things? We'll go backwards in Matthew. We just covered all those things. But he's saying when you see those things, the what's happening, know that he's near. He's right at the gate, in fact. He's very near. So you should be able to do that, right? Right. So when we see things coming down, and we've talked about this for the last couple of weeks, you see the degradation of mankind. You see the increase of corruption, and especially corruption. When you see all this stuff happening, and he talks about it earlier, when you see this all coming to a head and it's really there, you know that today we're closer to Jesus' return than yesterday because we're seeing the tree blossom in terms of all this stuff. So that's all he's saying. There's no magic here. You should be able to do this is all he's saying. And then it goes on and says, truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. This has launched so many books on the end times, pivoting only on what does this generation mean? What does this generation mean? And so much interpretation. Jesus is not being real specific here. He's not making it easy for us to understand this. But some people will say, well, this generation means the people that see all that stuff happening, they won't die until it finishes, till Jesus comes back. That's not a bad interpretation. Or some people will say, no, we're talking about the apostles who are listening to him right now. So Jesus is looking at the apostles and saying, this generation. Well, they did actually, many of them, probably see the fall of Jerusalem in 70 AD. But they didn't see the return of Jesus. Unless somehow the fall of the temple was the return of Jesus. And by the way, some people hold to that. What? Well, I know. This is where it gets kind of interesting. But we know from what we've looked at in Matthew 24 already that Jesus is not going to play hide and seek when he comes back. Remember that? Every eye will see. So if he did come back in 70 AD, almost everyone missed it. And that doesn't square with Matthew 24. So anyway, that's, some people think that this is the apostles. But I have a different opinion, and you can have a different opinion as well. It's sort of fun to think about this. What I normally do, again, when you interpret the Bible, use the Bible to interpret itself. See, I went back and thought, did Jesus ever use this term, this generation, before with anybody else? Ah, maybe he's using it the same way. Ah, so let me show you where he does. Right here, Matthew 23, it was in just the previous chapter. He's standing in front of the Pharisees, who are not really squared away, spiritually speaking. He's really giving it to them. I mean, both barrels. Go back and read Matthew 23. He is not meek and mild with the Pharisees. He's letting them have it. Scathing. So he says this to them. You can kind of tell in the words he uses. You serpents, you brood of vipers, how are you to escape being sentenced to hell? This is the Pharisees. These are the professional do-gooders. Therefore, I send you prophets and wise men and scribes, some of whom you will kill and crucify, some you will flog in your synagogues and persecute from town to town. That means you go chasing after them. So that on you may come all the righteous blood shed on earth, from the blood of righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, the son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the sanctuary and the altar. It's pretty severe. Truly I say to you, all these things will come upon this generation. Is he talking about just the guys standing there? I mean, not necessarily, because he's actually putting the guilt of this persecution that the religious structure in Israel had they had unrightly put on the prophets, people God had sent to them to speak truth to them, and they would kill them instead. Who are we talking about? Isaiah, Jeremiah. I mean, many of those guys. Isaiah, a legend has it, so we're not really sure. Isaiah was killed by being sawn in half inside of a hollow log. So the prophets that you see in the Old Testament, especially the latter ones, were not well received. And Jesus is saying, you're the guys that didn't receive them well, and you're the guys that killed them and crucified them. Well, it's clearly not this generation, because we're talking hundreds of years of people. In this generation, he's talking about the people with this attitude toward my messengers. That's this generation right here. So he's not talking about how long you live and the 70 years and all that. He's not talking about that at all. But he's still calling him this generation. Characterize him not by how long they live, but what their heart attitude is, this generation. We would say these type of people. What kind of types? The people who have that kind of antagonism against God, who disregard the messengers of God. Yes, Steve?
What was the Greek interpretation of that?
It's exactly the same. Yeah, it's exactly the same. So that's why, if you've got Bible study software, you can ask yourself from the previous verse in Matthew 24, where do you see this generation? Find out the Greek word, find out everywhere it's used again, and there's Jesus using it just in the previous chapter. So it's not a bad thing to say this may indeed be exactly what he means when he says this generation. So why does he use it in this context right here? He uses it here because he says the people of this generation, the people with that kind of heart, they will not pass away until all these things take place. That is, the people, if he's talking about the Matthew 23 people, the people who sin so egregiously and who so deliberately clog their ears not to listen to God, these people don't get a bye. They'll still be here when this happens. They won't pass away. So that's kind of what we're getting at.
That's something to me.
Yeah. And in the Matthew 23 passage, definitely he's pointing not just at anyone who doesn't listen to God. He's pointing specifically at the Jews, ethnically, who should be listening to God, because they've got an inside line. They should be the ones who hear God. And yet when God sends his prophets, they go la, 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 and they don't. So the people who really ought to respond aren't responding. It could very well mean that here, remember we looked at the tribulation, the horrible times coming just before the end? He may be actually saying here, the people who go la, 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 la to God are going to be there when the end comes. It could very well be because of their attitude that they're part of that end. So that's another way of interpreting this. But you can interpret any way you want, because this is DIY Apocalypse. But I favor that because it matches Matthew 23. So, and then he says, 35, we read this morning, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. So why does he say that right here? Why is that really important? It's not going to change. So he's saying, listen, I've said this, And it's going to happen. It will happen. Because when I speak, it happens. Remember the E.F. Hutton commercials? No, not if you're not old enough. But you know, the E.F. Hutton commercials, the stockbroker was, when E.F. Hutton speaks, people listen. Well, Jesus is saying, when I speak, it happens. Now, God is the only one in the universe who can speak reality into existence. The only one. How do we know that? Genesis 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and earth, and God said, let there be light, and there was light. God can speak, and it happens. So here, Jesus is saying, Jesus is speaking just like God, because he is God. So when he says, this is going to happen, no one's going to escape this, and I say this about this generation, it's going to happen. Don't you even start to think that it's not going to happen, because I've spoken it. It's going to happen. By the way, as an aside, and this is an interesting aside, Satan wants to be like God, but Satan can't speak things into existence. Only God can do that. He can't speak and have that stuff happen. But he is the father of lies. So he speaks and fools you into thinking it happens. So he's like God in speaking those things. He does most of his work in our hearts and lies of deception through his words, like God uses his words. God's words come into reality. Satan's words turn into deception and get you to think reality changed. Isn't that interesting? So he's like God, but totally opposite. He cannot fulfill his promises. He just can't do it. So you got to be careful. When God speaks, it will happen. Whether it has already or not, I mean, that's a different thing. But Jesus is saying right here, it's going to happen. Heaven and earth will pass away. So we quote this verse a lot about everything Jesus said, and it's not wrong to apply it to everything Jesus said. But just remember the context when Jesus said this was about what he's trying to tell us about the end times. He said that it will happen. Now, if you read one of Peter's letters, Peter was defending against the fact that people were saying, okay, we know Jesus is supposed to come back, but he hasn't come back yet. Presumptively, it's been decades when Peter writes this letter. He hasn't come back yet, so what's the deal? Did God change his mind? Well, Peter says, no, God didn't change his mind. He said it's going to happen. It just hasn't happened yet. It's going to happen. And this is the refrain that we've had from Christians for the last 2,000 years. Did God forget, or will it still happen? It'll still happen. Now, I got to be clear with you. Many, many secular people who look at Jesus will cut Jesus a break and say, I like how he taught. He taught good ethical and moral things, things I can pattern my life after, and that's just great. But Jesus talked a lot about coming back. So if you want to accept Jesus' good, wise statements, render unto Caesar things are Caesar, things are God's are God's, if you like those statements, you still have to also accept his word about his coming back. And Jesus said many times, I'm coming back. I'm coming back. And here we are 2,000 years later, and we can say, well, did he miss it? No, he's still coming back. So as powerfully as he spoke those other words, his promise to come back is just as powerful and just as potent and could be tomorrow. So his words don't pass away. So don't try him. He's not bluffing is what he's trying to say right here. Well, concerning that day, he says, and the hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but the Father only. Wow, has this caused lots of discussion? You mean Jesus, who is equal with God, doesn't know when the second coming is going to happen? Yeah. How can that be? Well, you know, I don't know. There's something about the incarnate God, God in the flesh in Jesus, that somehow the Son himself doesn't know. And how can that be? I don't know. We could spend days trying to figure this out. But we're just going to leave that on the page and go, isn't that interesting? However, that's not really the point, is to stimulate that discussion. The point is that concerning the day and the hour, that's a top secret. Top secret. Top secret. And why? And we'll get into that in just a second. Why is that a top secret? But here's a more of a conflict. If you're a Bible studier, he's telling you right here that you can't know. But didn't he just tell us we can know? Remember, he did this. Didn't he show us right here from the fig tree, learn its lesson? I'm supposed to learn the lesson as soon as the branch. And then you know when summer's. Didn't he in the beginning of the section say you can know just as simple as you can know from a fig tree? And now he's saying you can't know? Is this a contradiction? I mean, should we know or shouldn't we know? I'm just trying to figure this out. I'm reading the Bible and I want to know how this works, right? Well, interestingly enough, a lot of books on the New York Times bestseller list. A lot of books look at this contradiction and say, they conclude, so Jesus is going to come twice. One time that we'll know and one time that we don't know. Actually, that's an okay interpretation, but there's a much better explanation for this apparent conflict. And to help you understand it, let me take you to Alaska. This is Nanana, Alaska. And Dorothy and I went through Nanana in May. In May. There's a railroad bridge in the background back there. It was built in the early 1900s. It set a record, actually, for the length of its truss span. But anyway, here's Nanana, Alaska. It's on the Tanana River. And there's only like 300 people that live there. Not a big place. But we took the train from Fairbanks, Alaska, south toward Anchorage. And you got to go across that bridge and to that little train station right there next to the Tanana River. And if you're there, usually in your train they'll stop and you'll look outside and you'll see a crazy looking thing. It looks like a bunch of telephone poles lashed together in a tripod and painted white and black. And then they tell you about this thing called the Nanana Ice Classic. Here's a brochure for this year, 2016. It's a great thing. It's a big lottery. It's a lottery that the 300 people in this town put on. And it's really cool. This is what they do. They go out on the Tanana River around March of every year. This is them doing it this last year. They go out, and there's that thing. It's like a two-story tall. It's poles and white and black, and it's got a flag on it. And most importantly, it has a long rope on it, too. But anyway, they put it about 300 feet into the river, 300 feet from the shore, and they take that rope, they string it back to a clock on shore, because what they want to do in the lottery is guess when that thing is going to go down. They're guessing on when the ice goes away. Now, it's really cool. This started way back. They did the 100th anniversary this year because it was started back with the railroad workers who built that bridge back there. The railroad workers in the middle of the wintertime would get stuck there. You couldn't have supply ships come up the Tanana River from Anchorage. It was really kind of a bummer. So they started putting into a pool bets about when the ice was going to break up and the boats could come back. And they'd put this in a pool, and the winner who gets closest to it wins all. Well, that has grown over the last 100 years. To where the donations into the pool in 2015 totaled $330,000. Now, that's at $2.50 a guess. So there's over 100,000 people who are guessing on when this crazy-looking thing is going to pull the chain. It's better than the lottery. It is. It is. And, you know, in Alaska, especially in Nanana, this is a big deal. This is a cool deal. They have the Ice Classic days in March when they put this out there, and they have a festival and stuff like that. It's a big deal. But they know that in March is a good time to put it out there because by March, the river has frozen to over 3.5 feet thick. 3.5 feet thick. And when 1 month's time after this, the ice will start flowing. Really? It'll start moving. Actually, the ice doesn't just go away and that thing doesn't sink into the water. What happens is the ice starts to break and it moves like big chunks, like icebergs, and it pulls the cord and, you know, and then we know. Well, there's an automatic system to record the actual minute. You have to make your bet based on the day and the hour and the minute. And in 2015, $330,000, 28 people picked the right minute. So each one of them went home with over $10,000. Wow. I know, it's pretty darn cool. So here's what it looks like after they get it out there. It's just sitting out there. There it is, it's still sitting out there. There's bets coming in from all over the country. Although, by the way, because it's a lottery in Alaska, you can't have people playing this lottery from outside the state. So they put together kind of a system in which you can give your money to someone in the state who will place it for you. It's kind of crazy. Yeah, they make this work somehow. But anyway, there it sits out there. So then the clock is just running, and it's waiting for the clock that's 300 feet away on shore. It's waiting for the pin to be pulled out from it from when this thing, they call it a tripod, but it doesn't have three legs, it's got four. We don't worry about that. They wait for it to pull the pin out, for the clock to stop. They look at the minute on it, and they see who put their $2.50 bets on that minute. 28 people picked the minute in 2015. And so if you're interested, I've got the brochure right here. So, I've got family up there. You actually have to take this little card on the brochure and place it in a box in Nanana, So it's you put in the month, the date, the hour, and the minute, a.m. or p.m. Put your name and address. There you go. So if you're interested, Okay. So why are we talking about this? Actually, let me tell you, they put this out there in the early March, and then it fell through the, well, actually it didn't fall through the ice move. The Tanana River officially broke up on April 23rd, 2016 at 3:39 p.m. Alaska Standard Time. So if you're working on how to do this, just letting you know, that's, it's already done. Well, that was this year, that was the 100th anniversary, and it's gone. But now they're starting up for next year. Yeah, so why are we talking about this? Look back at the passage. Concerning the day or hour, nobody knows. What did he say about the fig tree? Well, he just talked about the coming of, it's a season. So we're not talking that in the seasonal sense, you should know the season when it's coming close, but no one's going to know the day or hour. So even on the Nanana Ice Classic, when you look at the tripod out there, I can give you a rough guess of the season that it'll move. It'll be in April or May. It has been for years. Everybody knows the season when the tripod will fall, when it will pull on the string. Everybody knows the season, but nobody knows the day, the hour, and the minute. That's the lottery, and that's a guess. Jesus is saying, when I return, everyone should know the season, because you'll see things moving that direction. You'll know the season, but nobody knows the top secret hour and minute and second. Nobody. And the most fine-tuned comment they can make about time is not minutes and seconds, because they didn't have watches. It's day and hour. That's the most precise timekeeping you do is day and hour, and even the hour is sort of a guess. So what Jesus is saying is that's top secret. The exact moment is top secret, but you have no excuse for not knowing when it's coming. That's what he's saying. You don't have to have two returns of Jesus. It works just fine, just like this. So remember, you'll know the season. You'll know when summer comes. But picking the day that the fig falls off the tree is impossible. That's what he's getting at. It's a specific time, right? So that's how we should be. We should all have an impending sense of the nearness of Jesus as we see the events in our culture moving in that direction. And no one should say it totally caught me by surprise, but none of us know exactly the moment. And that's all Jesus is saying. That's top secret. And we'll talk about that top secretness, because it's kind of a funny deal in a sense. Why would that have to be so top secret? So he's going to go in this last section this morning into what I call the unexpected and unaware syndrome in these next few verses. But before we get there, I want to show you a word, because it's going to come up several times. It looks like Perugia. And it's not a kind of, you know, fruit salad. That's what I've always thought it looked like. Want some Perugia? It's great stuff. No, it's not. Actually, it's pronounced Perugia. But it's a Greek word that's really cool. The pair in front is from the word para. Para always means with in Greek. And the ousia part is it's not a machine gun. It means to be. It's just the word to be. So parousia means to be with. And this is the word that's used through the New Testament when we talk about the return of Jesus. It's not just his return, it's his being with. His being with. It's literally Jesus being with. It emphasizes the fact that when he returns, he wants to be with us, which is a really warm kind of thing. And to let you know where it's used, here's where parousia is used in the New Testament. Oh my gosh, all those places. Write fast, because this is going to go away. I can give you the list later. But that's all the places that it shows up. The ones that have little asterisks are not about Jesus being with us. It's about other people being with him, with Paul when he writes his letters. But look at all those. This is actually a really good map if you want to go and look at more than just Matthew 24 and 25 about Jesus promising to be with us in the end. And so classically, you spend a lot of time in 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, a lot in 2nd Peter, and some in James and some of those others. So I'll put that list on the bulletin next week so you can have it. But this is, it's a great clue. Again, we're talking about how you'd study the Bible. This word, parousia, shows up how many times in Matthew 24? Well, at the very beginning, Matthew 24:3, and you know where that is? That was in their question to Jesus. Remember I quoted that before for you? When is your coming? When is your being with us going to happen? And now it shows up today, too, in 27 and 37 and 39. So I'll flag it as we go across, because I want you to understand when we see that word, it means, oh, there's one right now, his being with us. So Jesus goes on, for as were the days of Noah, so will be the parousia, the coming, the nearness, being with the Son of Man. As in the days of Noah, So what does that mean? Like there's going to be a big flood? When Jesus comes back, there'll be a flood? How do you know that? How do you know it's not? Because God promised. See, you are Bible scholars. And you interpret the Bible with the Bible, and the Bible earlier said that God's not going to do that. So that's a wrong interpretation. When we always talk about interpretation, you measure against what's in the Word. So how is it like the days of Noah if it's not a flood? That's the question. And Jesus himself will qualify that for us. He'll tell us. For as in the days before the flood, they were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage until the day when Noah entered the ark. So what he's saying is that there was normal life going on, and people were making long-term plans with each other. They were getting married. You know, they're doing all the natural stuff you do. Making plans are going to extend years into the future, you know, marriage proposals, all that kind of stuff. They're making long-term plans when they should never have been making long-term plans because the flood was coming. So they were totally unaware that doom was coming. They were totally unaware that a day was set when the flood would come and all mankind except those inside the ark would perish. But they're still making plans. They're totally unaware. So this is the unaware and the unexpected part of what Jesus is talking about. Until the day that Noah entered the ark, and then, well, and they were unaware until the flood came and swept them all away, so will be being with the Son of Man. So what conclusion do we draw? Yeah, it's not water. What he's saying is that it will be so unexpected, it'll just be as unexpected as those who watched Noah for 120 years build the ark and answer stupid questions from everyone and all the haranguing, and they said, I don't believe this stuff. We're just going to get married and eat and drink and do everything that we've normally done. And then the day came, and they just couldn't believe it. That's what it'll be like when the Son of Man comes back to be near again. No one will expect it. Now, we do, because of the fig tree illustration, suspect when it's getting near, but even we won't know the day or time, really. But for mankind who doesn't even know it's getting near, in their pride, they'll be making long-term plans that go on because they'll be humming the song from Annie, the sun will come up tomorrow, bet your bottom dollar that tomorrow there'll be sun. But it's not going to be. There's an end coming. They'll be totally clueless until the very end. That's all Jesus is saying. Very easy to interpret the Bible when you use it itself. They'll be unaware at the very end. 40, there'll be two men in the field, and one will be taken and one left, and two women will be grinding in the mill, and one will be taken and one left. Again, a very famous passage that has spawned dozens of professional books. What in the world does that mean? Well, remember, last week we looked at the fact that at the end, it is coming, he's going to gather the elect. So presumably this is him gathering the elect. I mean, that's the best conclusion you can make. But what's interesting is that two men will be in a field, working a field, doing something. One, the elect, will be taken by the returning Christ, and one will remain. That's kind of interesting. And the same with the women who are grinding. In fact, when you work a field, you're working on a long-term payback when you work a field. You're working on next year's crop. It's the long-term planning. It's what Jesus just said. They'll be clueless. They'll be making long-term plans. Well, they'll even be out planting fields, working fields, like there's going to be another harvest next year. But what's interesting is that you don't have just non-believers doing this. You have those who expect the coming of Jesus working alongside those who don't expect the coming of Jesus. That's all he's saying. And in contrast to, if you knew that Jesus was coming back next week and you were part of a cult, your cult leader might say, I know Jesus is coming back next week. Let's all gather together on the mountain and we'll live for the next week apart from mankind and we'll wait for him and look to the sky and, you know, those poor suckers down there are going to be taken away, but we will be ready, right? Yeah. So here's the deal. He's saying that when Jesus comes, those who are expecting his return will be working right alongside those who aren't. They'll be doing the same things they've always done, and there's nothing wrong with that. Don't go off and start a cult where you stand on a mountain waiting for Jesus. Stay in the culture. Stay working side by side. That's all he's saying right here. There's nothing crazy going on right here. That's all he's saying. One will be taken, one will be left behind. Working on long-term needs, and there's nothing wrong with that. Therefore, stay awake, for you don't know on what day the Lord is coming. The specific day, you don't know. So stay awake. So this is the beginning of his admonitions to us, which will actually continue through the rest of the chapter and through 25. What do I do while I'm waiting? Well, stay awake. I mean, live life knowing he's coming back soon. Have that be part of your thinking. Have that be your anticipation in all that's going on. Even if you find success in this world and things go good for you, he says you have to constantly be thinking Jesus could come back any second, and that's what I strain forward to keep in my mind all the time, not how I'm going to make a killing in the stock market next year. I strain forward to him. Keep your eyes on Jesus is what he told us, and that's what we need to do. Because you don't know the exact date and time, but you know that you're in the right season to expect him, well, your only option is to watch. Watch, stay awake, because you don't know when it's going to happen. And so it's a really important thing. Live life knowing that he's coming back. And that changes everything about you, right? For instance, if you knew he was coming back next Tuesday, and what would you do between now and next Tuesday? Well, it depends on what your biblical orientation is. If you were a non-believer in Jesus, if you weren't a follower of Jesus, and you knew he was coming back next Tuesday, not only would you just not believe it, but even if you thought, well, maybe if that's true, then between now and next Tuesday, I'll just, you know, woo-hoo, I'll just live a crazy life, and then I'll repent minutes before he comes back. Doesn't work that way, exactly. But that's your temptation. But anyway, so here's this expectation. That should change you. That should make it so that even when you're working alongside someone in the field, you know, at work, or grinding flour together with someone, that should be, I can't wait for him to come back, and everything's telling me it could be soon. I can't wait to see him. Can't wait to see him. Be awesome. It'll continually put that on your lips throughout your life if you're anticipating it. Because I got to tell you, between me and you, it doesn't matter about how the events in the world are going down, and they're going down, and not up, they're going down, but I can't wait to see him. I really can't. But I know as I read Peter's letters that God's not being deliberately slow. He's desirous that all should come to repentance. He wants to really maximize this harvest. So that's why it looks slow, but it's not. But I can't wait to see him. It'll be awesome. The end times, the latter days, starts when Jesus comes the first time. It's extending right now. You're in the last days. And the last days will continue until the last day comes. So that's what we're talking with prophecy. It's kind of a smeared timeline. The Messiah does indeed enter into the timeline of humanity. He enters in his first coming 2,000 years ago. He still entered through you as his Holy Spirit lives in you. And then he comes out at the end of the age and justice happens and all evil goes away. So when does the age, this present age end? Well, it started ending when Jesus came back. It'll finish ending when he comes back the second time. A lot of what you read in the Old Testament and into the New is not only historically real, but it's future historically a type. That's why we talk about Antiochus Epiphanes in 168 BC going into the temple and doing the abomination of desolation. Real history, a type of what will be real history to come. Sacking of Jerusalem 70 AD, real history, a type and a prefiguring of a real history still to come. So these things all, God's trying to tell us throughout history, you should have known because I did it once before and now this is just like that. We need to get toward the end here. 43, but know this. If the master of the house had known in what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would not have let his house be broken into. I got to slow down with this because there's kind of a weird logic right here. Let me read you the next part of it too. Therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour you don't expect. So what is he talking about? If the master of the house had known at what part of the night the thief was coming, he would have stayed awake and would have not let his house be broken into. So he did know someone was coming to break into the house. That's the season idea. And he knew it was probably going to be this night. That's still the season idea. But he didn't know the exact hour. See the difference? Part of the night, he knew it would be in the night, but he didn't know the exact hour. So what do you do if you know someone's planning to break into your house tomorrow night, you don't know the exact hour, but you know it's going to be during the nighttime, so when it gets dark after you've had dinner, what do you do? Go to sleep. Go to sleep and set my alarm clock for when he's coming. No, because you don't know when he's coming. So the idea is to thwart it, you stay awake. And that's all he's saying. You don't know the exact moment. Now, if I knew the exact moment, I could get out my smartphone, put the alarm on there for 5 minutes before. I could take a snoozer until he shows up at 3:05 a.m., and then my alarm will go off, and I can wake up and get the gun and be all ready for him. But you can't do that. So the only option? Stay awake. Not because you don't know it's that night, again, the season, only because you don't know the actual hour.
So you get an alarm to wake you up.
Yeah. No. So that's all he's saying. This just makes a ton of sense. That's how we are. Jesus coming back is going to be like a thief in the night. Have you heard that? This is what he's talking about, which means you don't know exactly when, but you got a pretty good idea on what day it is. That's all. So your only option? Stay awake. That's what you got to do. You got to stay awake. We're going to move on. So therefore, you also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an hour. So again, when you read scriptures, realize these time things. There's hour and there's part of the night. Those are not the same thing. And because the specific hour is right there, that makes you change what you do. You'll find this all through discussions of the end time stuff. There's loose references to the time. There's tight references to the time. The loose references, the seasons, you should be aware of when you're getting in that neighborhood. But the exact time, you won't. So what your only option is to stay awake. So we're gonna finish here today, and I've left the remainder of this chapter for next week because it just got too long. But he's going to talk about the whole issue of staying awake. What does that mean next week? So you can watch and wait. And then to answer the question about what do you do until he comes back, that's chapter 25. And it's in parables like the 10 virgins. So we're going to look at that and figure out through these parables, what do we do? But it's very clear right here. He's saying you don't know the exact moment, but you should know the relative kind of general time. You should see us moving closer to it all the time. So it shouldn't take you totally by surprise, but the exact time you don't know. The option then is stay awake. Be ready. Know that he's coming back. Keep in the forefront of your mind that Jesus is indeed returning. If all the prophecies in the Old Testament, and there are dozens that prophesied his coming the first time, came true, and they're documentable, these aren't just wishful thinking. If those came true for his first coming, then when Jesus himself says he's coming a second time, you can take it to the bank. It's going to happen. Because when he speaks, it happens. Who knows? Okay, we need to wrap up right here. Let me just give you one more passage and then we'll go from there. And this is interesting. It's instructive for us. Just before Jesus ascended, this is James Tissot's version of the ascension of Jesus. I don't know. I like it. Whatever. That's Jerusalem in the background. We're standing on the Mount of Olives. And he goes up and, of course, he leaves his apostles and many people actually waiting for him and see him go up. Later, some angels come and say, why are you looking in the sky? But anyway, what I wanted to quote for you is this. Just before he goes up, this is their last chance to ask him questions. Their last chance. So when they had come together, they asked him. This is from Acts 1, by the way, Acts 1:6. When they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? I mean, they were still wondering, right up to the very last minute before his ascension. Is this the day? Here we are up on the Mount of Olives. We can look across the Kidron Valley. We can look right at the temple. We can see all the bad guys over there. Today is it when you're going to woof and you're going to take over everything. The kingdom will complete its coming, which is really what they're talking about. Is today the day? Jesus' response is instructive because this is his last chance to talk about this issue. So here's his response. He said to them, it's not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. Now, he said seasons there. You know, he really is much more specific than what he talked about before. He's not being in conflict. But he's saying, listen, you're still asking the wrong question. You know, because they're asking, is today? Is it today? Right, exactly. But what he says in response after this is very instructive. And it'll be our introduction into what you're supposed to do until he comes back. Because that's the important question. What do I do until you come back? And this is a famous passage that we quote all the time. And forget it's in this context. So they're asking for the kingdom to come back right now. He said, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the end of the earth. That's what you do until I come back. Now that's going to come up many times as we go on through the rest of Matthew 25. But here's the deal. The reason that you're still here is so that you can talk about Jesus. Well, how long do we talk about Jesus? When are you coming back, Jesus? When can I stop talking about you? Wrong question again. It doesn't really matter. Does it change what I do tomorrow if I know he's coming back in 2020 instead of 2050? No. Or if he's coming back tomorrow? No. So the issue is, what do you do until he comes back? And what is, in where the rubber meets the road, what is an attitude of expectation an anticipation. How does that work itself into what people see of you and hear from you between now and the red X on the calendar? And forget about where to put it on the calendar. But you do know enough about the signs of the times right now to know that we're closer today than we were before. And so we're in the season and we're seeing the fig tree budding, and we know that the season's coming, and we might be right in the smack dab in the middle of it now. And I'm convinced now more than ever before, he's closer to coming today than he was last week. And that kind of urgency, because you don't know the hour, should infect your speech all the time. He's coming, he's coming, he's coming. Can I tell you about this Jesus who is not just an old 2,000-year-old figure of history? He's the one who was and who is and who is to come. And he will come because he said he would. And his word is sure. Can I tell you about this Jesus who loves you? And in that context, mankind needs to know he's coming. He's not just an antiquated notion of a person in history. He is the real saving Jesus right now who wants to be in your midst. And a day is coming when he will, parousia, he will be with us again. That's the message. Okay, let's pray. We're going to sing a song of Fanny Crosby again, I think. This is my story, this is my song, praising my Savior all the day long, watching and waiting, looking above. Huh? So watch for those words, they're in this song. Let me just pray, and then we'll do that. Father in heaven, we are so excited about your coming again. We are so excited about that your Spirit inside of us indwells us, and your desire to be with us, parousia, has already started as we've given our hearts and lives to you right now. But there is a day coming in which, in reality, on a much larger scale, evil will tremble as the just and righteous God returns to bring an end to the previous age where the prince of the power of the air brought anguish and suffering and decay. So we do look forward to that day. Well, we pray for those who don't know. And while we still are praying with our heads down, I don't know where you're at in terms of anticipating his coming. I don't know whether you yourself have given your heart and your life to him. He loves you tremendously. And this information and this anticipation of his coming shouldn't just scare us into Jesus' arms because judgment's coming. But I want to say to you, he loves you and he wants to be near you. He wants to be looking at you and calling you his elect, the ones he loves. And he isn't just an academic piece of history. He is the near God who wants to live in us and amongst us and with us and be intimately close to us. So if you haven't given your heart to him, you can do it just simply where you're sitting. And you can say, God, I want you. I've come to understand you're the God who wants to be with us. The parousia, to be with us. And that you want to be with me. And yet I understand that I'm not really worthy of this place in your coming kingdom. But I also understand because you died for me, you have made me worthy, not because of my work, but because of your work finished on the cross that day, so that we might be saved from sin and evil and death and saved to a glorious kingdom where God is with us. So you can give your life to him right now, just silently, and say, God, that's what I want. That's what I want. Life in you. Life with you. And if you say that silently right now, he will come. He will come. Because as the prophet Joel says in chapter 2, all those who call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Lord, we thank you that you've spoken to our hearts. You've invited us to your kingdom, and a kingdom that's not just built with stones and with golden streets and all that stuff, but a kingdom where we can live and find life with you in our midst, so that life and light itself comes from you. And Lord, we look forward to that day when you come in great glory, and as Jesus had prayed for us in John 17, and we will with our own eyes see your glory that you had before the beginning of the universe. And we just know a little right now, but we anticipate so much more. We love you, and we pray that because of our love for you and the urgency of the time, that you might move us a little more quickly with the people we know who don't know you, that you might give us words in our tongues that are a little more bent toward you and your coming, which could be any second, and that we might be capable lights, city on a hill whose light shines and communicates the one that the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords loves you, this King of Kings who was and who is to come. So Lord, make us capable speakers of that incredible truth of your loving kindness toward us. Thank you now, in Jesus' name, amen. Blessed is your